Hello, everybody. This is James and Joyce Skeet. In this series, we're going to be talking about six sacred stones of regenerative farming. This sacred stone is holding soil sacred. We will cover aspects of soil, the implication of soil disturbance. In the last 200,000 years or more, human beings viewed an organic perspective or organic worldview. Once reality was interwoven, deeply connected to our environment, we were really attached. Reality was spirit-filled, landscapes with plants, animals, even objects that we think are non-living, like rocks, rivers, and mountains, all possess a spiritual essence. Now let's shift. For Europeans, it shifted in the last 10,000 years during the so-called Renaissance in the late 15th century. It increased as the Industrial Revolution, shaking off the organic worldview to a mechanical industrial worldview. Science, using reductionist thinking, disembodied itself from sort of a spiritual ethical premise. So it became a very reductionist approach to a worldview. It also shaped the economy into a currency-based system during that time and encouraged colonialism and also extractive economy, extractive exploits all across the globe. My name is James Skeet. I'm a Navajo Diné tribe. My clan is Jatlashche and Kiaani Abashashin, which means a red sheep born of Leaning Tara clan. My wife is Joyce Skeet from the state of Pennsylvania, relocated to New Mexico some 30 plus years. Since that time, she has been on this fast track to indigenization within the Diné culture, which is kind of a natural sort of incorporating stories and cosmology.
Hello, everybody. It's been a big learning experience for me to go down a different track and really learn more about listening to my own spiritual being and spiritual outside voices from the plants, from the animals, from the spirit world.
Mother Earth is an archetype. It's a symbolic mystery. It's the great mystery. It nurtures, which brings life as well as receives life when we've journeyed in our lifetime on this earth. Indigenization holds all things sacred, from the sky, earth, to our soil. It lays an ethical basis to treat our world with discretion and honor. I just want to read you a quote that Luther Standing Bear, I came across in some of my studies. And let me just read that to you. The native was a true naturalist, a lover of nature. He loved the earth, all things of the earth, and the attachment grew with age. The old people came literally to love the soil, and they sat on, reclined on the ground with a feeling of being close to mothering power. It was good for the skin to touch the earth, and the old people liked to remove their moccasins and walk with bare feet on the sacred earth. Their dwellings were built upon the earth. Their altars were made of earth. The birds that flew in the air came to rest upon the earth, and it was the final abiding place of all things that lived and grew. The soil was soothing, strengthening, cleansing, and healing. This is why the old Indian still sits upon the earth, instead of propping himself up and away from its life-giving force. For him to sit or lie upon the earth is to be able to think more deeply and to feel more keenly. He can see more clearly in the mysteries of life and come closer in kinship to others, other lives about him. That was Chief Luther Standing Bear. So our organization, which started in 2015, we were introduced to life in the soil. Since that time, we've come to establish our own homegrown approach to growing, we call indigenous regenerative intelligence. So in this series, you'll see attempts to define and secure the principles into six cohesive pillars called six sacred stones. Stones to many folks are non-living, inanimate objects, but to indigenous people, all things are sacred, even stones. Our farm, Spirit Farm, is a demonstration farm that uses only natural practices, including microbial composting to heal the high desert southwestern soil and be a living example of how we can recover and reclaim traditional farming and spiritual practices. Those are very much interwoven. There's no split duality. The farm provides visual models and discussion opportunities with growers of methods that can increase the quantity and quality of their produce, as well as use less water, which is a critical step when growing food in our climate. We want to reattach, reconnect with the soil. but we must first honor the soil and the microbes. So our mission is to grow growers and demonstrate the possibility, and our vision is to emulate nature's patterns and follow ancient rhythms. Holding soil sacred, value microbes by minimizing soil disturbance.
We hold soil, or another word, Mother Earth, very sacredly because of the microbes and how much life they give to all of us. Our goal here on the farm is to increase the nutrients in all the foods. The nutrients increase when the soil microbes are living and active. We test our soils for the microbes several times a year during the growing season. It's that important to us. Mother Earth does know how to feed us all and with rich nutrients. When we plow or till, we are killing microbes and tearing down their living spaces. It's like tearing down our own houses, and now we have to rebuild again. So it takes away from the microbes' ability to really do their function and their job in the soil. We have found over and over again that when the ground is disturbed, whether it's tilled or plowed, the worms are not present. Compared to soil that isn't tilled, it is full of worms. But if the ground is hard, for the first time going into planting, we will till or plow, but then no more after that. One of the best ways for us to prep our gardens is using a broad fork, because it doesn't turn the ground over. It just puts air holes into the soil. In the grazing areas on a property, we mimic nature and use the sheep, the pigs, and the chickens to disturb the soils. Sometimes we want to go out and plant the cover crops. We'll use a planter with minimal soil disturbance, only 1 to 2 inches into the ground.
So the implication of soil disturbance, there is some repercussions to our industrial way of farming. Let me tell you a little story about my grandpa. My grandpa's name was Money Skeet. And the way he got his name, Money, is even very, very interesting. He used to hang around the trading posts about 8 miles from where we live, called Gahyeje, which means Little Rabbit. It was Mormon missionaries that lived out there, and that's how I got my name, James, as one of the disciples, I guess. But Money would hang out as a little boy, and the Mormon missionary trading post attendant would say, "What do you want?" And Money would say, "Money." He was an incredible entrepreneur and very open to new ideas and new perspectives. So he took on a lot of what we call the white man's ways. Grandpa plowed, and the area that he plowed 50, 60 years later, we are still trying to recover that soil. He grew beans, corns, and squash, the three sisters, as we call them. But in his plowing, one of the things that has happened, colonization is a part of that industrial system. So what took place was, instead of using the planting stick to plant and minimal disturbance, Money took his plow first with the horses and then eventually with gasoline tractors and plowed really the tarnation out of the soil that we had. So 50, 60 years later, we're trying to recover that topsoil. What we have is a lot of invasive species like the sage and the cedar, where there used to be grasses. We had summer and winter migrations with sheep, and we had tall grasses in that field. We also have another program that we call Tractors Do Not Poop. Tractors Do Not Poop. I think the introduction of tractors is when we stop using manure and compost. This industrial way of farming is about production. And further on, as we develop this monocropping mass production, the produce is looking really good, really big, but it doesn't have the nutrient density because it does not have good soil. The seeds are hybrid to make plants and produce look robust. But the problem is it does not have the microbial activity that provides the nutrients for the plants so that the plants can become very nutrient dense. In fact, some of the seeds that we're picking up from some of the native corn is a lot more denser in nutrient density than some of the seeds from the stores. Farming techniques was a way to colonize indigenous farmers. So what we have all along the Rio Grande and also up where we're at is indigenous farmers stick to the plow, stick to that kind of monocropping farming instead of mimicking Mother Nature, the diversity. The diversity is important in the soil itself and the protection of that soil, understanding the kinship and the relationship that we have to that soil is so important. So a lot of indigenous people, when they were colonized, what happened, what broke down was our relationship to help one another. Because farming requires that you help each other. Our neighbor farmer comes in and helps us harvest or helps us plant. So a lot of indigenous people had this network, just like the fungi does. It has these strands that have relationships, and they can carry nutrients along these strands. A lot of that has been broken. So a lot of indigenous people are no longer really practicing their indigenous ways, the rhythms, the practices. Because of the industrial introduction of farming, the indigenous farmer has become colonized, therefore no longer have that really key relationship with their neighbors, as well as the microbes in the soil and understanding that soil.
We really miss seeing the kinship of the farmers coming together as we drive along from our place into Gallup. We only see tractor or one or two people out there outside working, where 50, 60 years ago, you would see 10, 20, 30 people working together to help one farmer and go to the next farm and help. Another disturbance on the soil is using chemicals. It's a good thing to remember that chemistry and the soil microbes, or the biology, work together. But often people just focus on the chemicals, and this can be inorganic chemicals, including fungicides, herbicides, pesticides, all the sides, which mean death. Or it can also include the organic applications that are allowed in organic farmers. I'm going to move to the organic applications. While they're organic and in essence, they are not harmful to us, what it does is the plants now are become dependent on the organic fertilizers to feed the plants, rather than having the focusing on the soil biology feed the plants. So in our regenerative agriculture approach here on our farm, using the natural approach and the microbiology, our focus is to really build up the microbes in the soil, to build healthy soil, to increase the soil microbes, so that the soil microbes can be the ones that feed the plants, because they do a much better job than we can ever, ever do. With this, it does result in a lot higher levels of nutrients in our foods. We increase the microbes in the soil using the compost we make, compost extracts in our gardens, and also maintaining good moisture levels for the microbes. In the last session, we talked about water and water sequestration. And this session, and moving forward, carbon sequestration becomes another topic we all need to focusing on to heal Mother Earth and to heal nature, heal Father Sky, to really just begin the water cycles going again. And the biggest place where carbon is sequestrated is by the roots of the plants. And so the more roots of the plants that we can get into the soil, the more we can sequester carbon into our soils. The next sacred stone we'll be talking about will be reconnecting with the microbes. And we'll be talking about that more as we move forward here.
And it's really about disconnection and reconnection and indigenization and going back, making our history our future for indigenous people. It is so important that we come back to ourselves. It's a migration back to center. So bringing a lot of these things together, it is estimated that about 70% of the bugs are no longer on the face of the earth. And that's a big, big number. And those, what we so-called pests, are really pollinators, and they help us out. So Mother Nature, in its wisdom and its perspective, has created this kind of complex web. It's the great mystery. It's the great understanding of our relationship and our reconnectedness is so important. We want to promote indigenous regenerative intelligence. Our Diné culture often looks at different stones and different archetypes within our community and our indigenous perspective to hold these ties together so that we have an ethical, spiritual relationship. An indigenous perspective is really just to look at local resources, a way of transformative self-sufficiency. What we're dealing with in this pandemic is people trying to get back to normal, the way things were. I think right now, regenerative agriculture, regenerative farming is really beginning to move all across this country. And so a lot of the things that we're looking at is how do we nurture that? How do we move it forward? And the regenerative intelligence is really about using the indigenous cosmology. We need to go back, break down the colonization, global warming that's taken place, the dependency on currency-based economy. I almost think that we need to get back to bartering systems where we exchange a sheep for a goat or exchange foods in that way so that we really aren't dependent on a currency system. When we speak regenerative, we're referring to that economy, that culture, that agriculture that needs to change. We're talking about mimicking Mother Nature. Patterns are away from a reductionist compartmentalization towards a biosystem perspective of how the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Taking things much more sacredly, spiritually, having an ethical foundation on why we do things, not just what we do, but how we do it. We need to conduct ourselves and celebrate our ancient traditions as Native people as we adapt. We've been adapting for 400 years, and some of this adaptation we need to toss and begin to migrate back into our traditional ways. And many of those traditional ways are open in interpretation. It's not just legalistic or something that's set in stone. It's not absolute. It's a transforming way of coexisting and honoring the sacredness of life, to be symbiotic in our relationship with Mother Nature on how to keep kinship with all living things. We want to thank you for listening to this series of podcasts on sacred stones. We hope that as you're growing your farm, as well as you growing spiritually, that you'll begin to understand that it's so much of what Indigenous people have laid the foundation for is very important, and we need to migrate back to that. So if you want more information, please get on our website, covenantpathways.org. Thank you very much.